Hi everybody, so today's video is a continuation of the live video that I did the other day where I started painting this face of the cowboy. Alright, so we're gonna pick up where I left off and just keep going. It's going to be real-time painting, okay? So I've taken out all of the moments where my paintbrush is not touching the canvas, so I tried to speed it up as best I could but still give you that real-time painting with me in my studio situation. So let's get to it.
All right, so hopefully I'm zoomed in close enough for you there. I know a couple of you asked for me to zoom in so you can see my brush strokes better. Maybe I should get a macro lens so I can get you guys really close. All right, I'm using this Comber brush. And it looks like we've got a little bit of color here. Now I'm putting it in a little darker than what I think I need it to be, although value-wise, that's probably pretty close. Because the light's coming in this way, so his head would technically be creating a shadow, but I feel like there's a little reflective light coming up from the shirt, possibly. That scarf's gonna go right through there. And then that collar comes under there. I'm gonna lighten it up with this. Kind of pale purple color I have. Now, I want to make those brush marks where it just looks like he is moving. Can you guys see that? Yeah. So I put my brush parallel to the canvas and just lightly glide it in that direction. So this part of the collar is flipping up a little bit, so we're just going to let it catch a little light right there like that. And it's a nice light bit right here coming in, getting into our shirt. So his shirt has like this white area that's kind of a bib. Let's see, am I out of the frame? We're still good. I think that'll work. It's enough background in there to get our scarf started. All right. Now, the other thing I see, pull this hairline down just a touch. I'm going to make it a little bit darker than what's there. It's really closer to the head and underneath. So his shoulders are coming around. This shoulder is higher than this shoulder is supposed to be. So let's bring it down just a little bit more. And let's just a little flick of hair like so. Remember, he is on a fast moving horse. Nothing static in this situation. Nothing static. So what I see happening is the scarf area that I have here in the underpainting is a little wide still yet, so I'm gonna put in a little bit more of this collar. think what happened was the shoulder is coming up more. So let's see. I can't. There's a shadow here. See where his collar's gonna go. Okay, so this part of the collar's flipping up. So we get the little darker bit behind that collar. There we go. And let's see, I want to just bring his neck. That's my doggie. Her name's Kona. Kona. She is not a good listener. Just building up a little bit of that face structure here. A little short and got a little more beard coming in here. And it looks like you can see into his neck a little bit like that. Okay, I'm going in for some green. I think that's pretty good. It could maybe be a smidge lighter, but we'll put that in. Coming up. So I'm just kind of establishing the area that has this green, looking at the shape. I just grabbed a tiny bit more of that Naples yellow just to help me build up this highlight right here. Dragging that little bit of darker green into that highlight so it's not too bright. There we go. It's darker underneath. Here, where it goes into the beard a little bit. Comes down there. I seeing if I can leave some of that underpainting showing through right there. Makes it a little, it makes it interesting. And we want to highlight right there. And I flicked it that way because everything that's getting flicked is going in that direction. Because that's giving us that movement that I am experimenting with. Just gonna reinforce it. This is tickling the paint. Just so very lightly. A little tickle. So now, the even more exciting part, this bit of green that's flying away into the wind. So it needs to be in this direction. So if you're looking at the hands of a clock, 12, 1, 2, so it's aiming at 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock. So a couple of practice motion flicks, and we're gonna go right through there. That dog is just relentless. Get some nice paint on there. So it's going a little more up here. Like so. It kind of looks like it's twisting in the wind a little bit. So put a little bit of shadow twist color there. I'm going to use this darker color just there to suggest that shape. Putting in a little shadow detail here so we see the shape. I wiped my brush off with my paper towel between marks so it doesn't get contaminated. So that's looking pretty good. I want to wipe it off in between flicks. This is going to just help me reinforce that motion that I'm looking for. I don't want to overdo it, so I'll stop there. I'm wondering if I should make the end of that go out further. But for right now, I think I'll let it stand as is. I I'm gonna put that green brush, the brush I used with the green, aside. Because when you use green, it will get into all your other colors for sure, unless you clean that brush good. I don't keep turpentine, and I don't keep varnish, turpentine. I don't keep any odorless mineral spirits to clean my brushes. I just wipe them with the paper towel in between marks. All right, I am excited to paint this hand. So I mixed up a transparent oxide brown and some ultramarine blue and a touch of permanent mauve to get this black. I typically don't use black out of the tube. So I'm going to draw in this pistol. God, my dog's driving me nuts. She's barking at nothing. Okay. So there is a very, very, very bright highlight right on top here. Now, that highlight needs to aim pretty much directly at this eye, which I think we've got. So I want him to look like he's staring down the sight of that pistol to make his shot. So I'm looking at the shapes of colored light and trying to put them in the right place. And I'm going to drop down and put this one in here. Looks like it's aiming up. Now I altered the gun a little bit from the photo reference. I made it a little bit longer. I didn't like the length of the image, so I've got it coming out to about right there. See about a little background color to help shape this. There we go. Still looks a little like it's dipping down in the middle. All right, let me. Still shaping. This is a very important element to the composition. It must be right. feels pretty good. So there's light here on the barrel. Medium value shape right here, and another, there's a dark line just underneath here, like that. Just give it a little flick to the end of that to give us our motion blur. Under away from the light, so it's getting a little darker. And we want it to be a little bit warm, so I'm trying not to cover up my underpainting completely. I want to let a little bit of that stand in the shadow. It's helpful to paint your shadow areas kind of transparent, especially if you have the underpainting. This shape is facing the viewer and will be coming around like that towards the hand. And it's moving down into the area where you hold the pistol. What we can see is this shape looks, what does it look like? It's helpful if you can think of what your shapes look like. I don't really see, almost like a dialogue box. You know, one of those things that points towards your mouth and shows that you're saying something. Because the shadow's coming down around underneath his thumb. This is the thumb. Establish a little bit of that. So just about here, we have a dark shape. It's kind of like a triangle. There we go. It's on top of thumb. So it's getting hit by some light, and then the thumb dipping down, gripping that gun. Got a little thumbnail situation here. A little strange. Looks like he has fingernail polish on. Just dirty it up. We can come back to that. That's established enough for me to see, put in the side here. I was trying a little different direction of brush stroke just to add some interest as we come closer here towards the tip of the pistol. Finger there. It's got to be straight because it's metal. It doesn't bend. And this is the part that I made up. So I'm just going by what makes sense in my head and what looks good visually. Contrast in this element so it draws the viewer's eye to the head because it's our focal point. I am really punching up those highlights. Reference, it's almost, well, pretty much the same value as the skin. I think just playing with the highlight there. This is that leather cuff that he's wearing. Like a metal stud, probably a snap where it attaches. So we'll put it in. It's another way to punch up our contrast. I'll take it. Anywhere I can punch up contrast, I'll take it. Well, that's towards the close-up face. God, my dog is driving me mad. She's still barking at nothing. Hopefully you can't hear it. Let's put some finger here. Between, it's gonna be a nice dark, warm dark. So his fingers are angling completely up. So let's adjust. Let's adjust. Adjust that finger. tip of his finger is right here. And it's kind of overlapping. The index finger is overlapping the middle finger. Just about touching that thumb shadow right there. And then this middle finger's coming below like that. And the other finger, there's his knuckle. It's good with fingers to vary the thickness of that in-between line. You don't want it to be the same all the way the length of the finger. So this is the ring finger. And it's coming to about right here. We have our pinky finger. What is right below this finger is shirt. So let me grab a little shirt color and put this here. A little bit of a lighter bit of shirt on this cuff there. So there's a little more shirt right here than needs to be. Push it back. And I don't quite like how even that is. I'm gonna push him back a little bit, and then this guy needs to be carved right there. So now I'm looking to improve the volume or the form by establishing some lights and darks. sculpting my fingers. I've established pretty much where I want them. Now I just want to solidify the lights and darks of them. Like we can punch up some area of black here. And this paint is really wet, so I'm just lightly tickling it into the wet paint. Anywhere you have a light bit, if you can put your darkest dark next to your lightest light, you are for sure gonna have your vocal point being pulled that direction.
Hey, if you're getting some value out of this video, go ahead and hit that thumbs up button. And if you want to learn how to paint people, then be sure to subscribe to the channel. And you can come along with me on my art journey where I share everything that I learn about painting people and figures with you.
Give that barrel a little more meat. I think it's looking pretty good. Yeah, looking for areas to punch up my contrast. Little more shadow on this edge here. I'm using some saturation on the knuckles. Saturated color will come forward just as light colors do. Too high. Bring it down. A little of that saturated red here on the knuckle, which made this value a bit light there. This hand 30. I want to indicate some semblance of a fingernail there. And I don't want it to be too light.
Why do we whisper when we're doing something delicate?
It's funny, right? There could be a spot of light happening right here.
I like it. Now you can see it.
Needed more black. Looks like we could bring this shape down. Work a little bit more on the shirt, finish his pant. Got a pant and a boot. And then I'll show you the finishing touches.
Okay, this is the point that I've made it to so far. I'm gonna sit with it for a little while. I'm still kind of deciding if I like the saturation level in that field in the background. It may be too saturated. I may actually, once it's dry, go over it a little bit with some transparent oxide brown just to slightly tone it down. It's almost like glazing over top of it just to change the saturation intensity a little bit. I feel pretty good about the rider, the horse. I'm liking these elements of these abstract type brush strokes, and I've got the little cactus in finally, and I'm thinking about something crazy. I want to do something to this painting that makes it unexpected, unique, something so when you visually see it, it's not there initially, it doesn't slap you in the face, but something that will sneak up on you. I've done it in some of my other paintings, and I'm thinking I'm gonna do it. So the deal is, if I put these things in and I don't like it, I can just take them out because they'll be wet, and this will be dry enough. Yeah, so the background elements, they're pretty dry, so I think I could go ahead and give that a try. And if it's so totally dry and I don't like it, then all I have to do is wipe it off and no harm, no foul. And it's a great way to see. Now I could snap a photo of this and try it out in Photoshop if I don't want to try it out on the canvas, but I'm feeling pretty confident that I'm going to like the results. So I want to go ahead and give it a try on there, and I know I can take it away if I don't. So I will video that for a part 3, and hopefully you guys are enjoying seeing how this
more formal painting of mine is coming along. You're seeing the whole process unfold before your eyes. All right, I'm gonna do that. So if you made it this far in the process of this painting, thanks for sticking around with me. It's gonna be exciting to see. So I'll put a picture of this at the end of the video so you can see it in a more close-up static view. And tell me your thoughts. Do you think it should have an unexpected element? Tell me in the comments. Or do you think I should just leave well enough alone? Leave it alone. Don't touch it. You know, these are the thoughts that we have in our mind when the end. So this is my favorite part of the painting process, when I get to really push my creativity. So I've got the technical part out of the way. I've got all the compositional elements. You know, I've done everything I can do to this point to have a successful painting. The only thing I can do now is really push in my level of creativity and thought process that'll take it to a level that is beyond what you would expect. That's kind of the goal I have with this. So, you know, Western art is pretty common. There's a lot of people who do Western art. There's a lot of great Western art painters. So I have to push myself to offer something different, or offer a Western painting in a way that maybe you haven't seen before, or in a way that might be more surprising. You know what I'm saying? So that's what's going on. All right, guys, I will see you in the next one.